Hi, Francis. Welcome. Welcome back to the Dana Foundation and Rockefeller Center.
Great to be here.
We're excited to have a conversation with you today.
I'm excited. It's been fun.
Yeah, wonderful. Great. Well, why don't you go and have a seat?
Today, I am delighted to welcome Francis Shen to NeuroSociety Stories. Francis Shen is Chief Innovation Officer in the Center for Law, Brain, and Behavior at Massachusetts General Hospital. He's also a law professor at University of Minnesota, and he's a member of the Harvard Medical School's Center for Bioethics. Francis is also the recipient of the Early Career Scholars Medal from the American Law Institute, where he was awarded this for his pioneering work to establish the interdisciplinary field of neuroscience and law. Francis, welcome to the Dana Foundation.
Thank you, Caroline. It's great to be here.
You started out with an interest in law. Now you run a lab where the motto of the lab is every story is a brain story. Can you share with us how your interest in law linked to a career that includes brain science, neuroscience?
When I graduated college, if you had asked me to list 100 things I would do in my life, they would not involve neuroscience. And I think the reason is that I was really interested in law and in policymaking. And I didn't see any connection between law, public policy, political science, and the natural sciences. But when I got to graduate school, I was doing a joint program, a JD, PhD, and I was focusing on policy and legal responses to those who were survivors of trauma, both combat soldiers returning from then the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, and survivors of assault. And what I realized is that I didn't know enough about why some of those experiences were so traumatic, and I wanted to know more. When I discovered brain science through some mentors in graduate school, a light bulb just went on, and I realized, wow, it's not just that neuroscience helps me understand the people at the center of this law and policy, it also helps me understand how lawyers are thinking and judges are thinking, and beyond that, how people are making their decisions across the world. And this led to this brain motto, every story is a brain story. And that's really how I got into it, is through sort of just questioning why. And to me, brain science was the place where I ended up.
It sounds like it wasn't exactly a straight path. And maybe that path included some challenges in navigating how to go from one field to another. I wonder if you could share with us about some of the challenges you faced as you navigated your own career, and also how that turned into an inspiration to help others, other trainees with interdisciplinary interests, to navigate
their careers.
So the first big challenge was that, as I mentioned, you know, I was studying high-end social science and law, but I had no formal background in neuroscience. And so here I was getting super excited about the brain. And I had done some empirical work in psychology, but I didn't know anything about the brain. And so what do you do? I mean, through a combination of mentorship and luck, self-teaching, and really being immersed in the discipline. But I think that's a general challenge when you work at the intersection of multiple fields. You can't do everything all at once, but your interest might span different fields. And you know, the other way to try and help solve that is intensive teamwork, just working with a lot of collaborators. And that's really been, I think, the secret sauce on my career. So that's one challenge. A second challenge is that I got really interested in this area, neurolaw and neuropolitics, and sort of looked around and said, well, it doesn't seem like there are too many other people doing this. Again, a good combination of mentorship and luck. I got really lucky that just at the time I was finishing graduate school, the MacArthur Foundation happened to be funding a time-limited network in law and neuroscience project. And it just so happened that one of my mentors knew someone who was involved in that project. And lo and behold, I got a postdoc there. But if I had been just a few years earlier, or even a few years later, those opportunities wouldn't have been there. And on account of that, I really saw a need. And it wasn't just in neurolaw, it was in these other intersections too, neuroeconomics, neuromarketing, neuroethics, where there was growing interest, or others like me who became really intrigued and fascinated and wanted to learn more and do more, but couldn't figure out what the pathways were. But that's really the impetus, is my own experience of just being a combination of super excited and super confused about what exactly to do with all of my interest.
So the Dana Foundation started to partner with you on launching the Dana Career Network in Neuroscience and Society to support students like yourself when you were a trainee and figuring out your career path, to help them to navigate their exploration of careers with their cross-disciplinary interests. So I would love to hear from you what the goals of this career network are and how it's going so far.
So we're just reaching our sort of first year anniversary. And I think things are going great. So the mission of the Career Network is to expand and diversify the individuals and actors and doers in the fields of neuroscience. We didn't know when we did the first virtual career fair who would show up. I, in the back of my head, thought, you know, maybe we'll get like 300 people register and, I don't know, 80 or so will show up. We had 1,800 registrants for something that had never existed before. We're really excited about that. Since then, we've done a number of other events. We are getting close to 40 events so far. We have had students from those events or individuals come from over 300 different schools. They've come from over 25 different countries. And we've got, you know, over 3,000 people on a mailing list that goes out regularly. So in terms of reaching new people, I think we're on the right trajectory. We're really getting the word out. The second thing we wanted to do is just put information out there in the world about these fields, and especially about careers in these fields. And so we've really made the website, neuroxcareers.org, our home base for providing this information. And if you go on there now, you'll find, and we're still expanding, but we have, I don't know, 10 plus NeuroX fields, neuroeconomics, neuromarketing, neuropolitics, neurolaw, et cetera. And when you go, you can sort of learn a little about the field, see some videos. One thing we've done I'm really excited about is do stuff a little bit like what we're doing today. We have interviews on the site where people who've been successful in these fields talk about their paths. And I'll say the one common thread is that there are no common threads. Everyone has a unique story. Nobody like woke up in fourth grade and said, I want to go into a NeuroX field when I grow up. It's all one twist and turn, some luck here, some mentors there. And then that third prong, that's the toughest one, and that's where it's a longer term enterprise. We don't have some of the opportunities that I wish we would. In our own career network, when we hire RAs or fellows for the career network itself, we're getting hundreds of applications for just a few slots. I think right now, the younger generation is really, it's just resonating with them that, yeah, this makes sense. But the institutions where they might work are a little slower to come around to the idea. So we're trying to nudge those institutions too, but it's a longer term goal.
There is such a strong appetite coming from this next generation of trainees, especially those with these cross-disciplinary interests. And so that's one of the things that we, along with other partners, yourself and others, hope that we can help to harness that. You had talked about the term NeuroX. I wonder, you use this term quite a bit in the Career Network programs, and I was curious if you could share with us what you mean by NeuroX.
So when I use the term NeuroX, I mean it as shorthand for the intersection, so like the X intersection of neuroscience and society. And I think that's a two-way intersection, so I mean it broadly. On one hand, it's thinking about different parts of society, whether it's teaching kids in a classroom, or it's making political choices, or it's making legal choices, or it's providing social services, or making music. Anything in society might be improved or changed or informed by things we're learning about the brain. One of the really fun parts of this project is learning about fields that I didn't know were at the intersection of neuroscience and society. I knew a little about neurolaw and neuroethics and a few others. But for instance, one that I learned a lot about, which I love now, is neuroarchitecture. And at first, I was like, neuroarchitecture, what is that? And the more that I learned from colleagues, and by the way, we've done now a neuroarchitecture 101 program in the Career Network, it's all online. They explained to me, well, think about it. And then I did it, like, look, the built environment really affects the way that you process information. We've all experienced that, right? We walk into some place, I can't think here. I need to go there to clear my head. So it was really eye-opening. And it's related to these other fields because they gave me this example, American Academy of Neuroscience and Architecture. They said, you know, some of us got together when we were early on and said, as a policy matter, we're not going to be complicit in designing solitary confinement units because of the way that that architecture affects the brain negatively, you know, be involved in incarceration, but only with certain design principles. So it was really eye-opening. The other thing that's been really neat is to see connections between the fields. And I think there are three things that are really common to all of these NeuroX fields. The first is that they're really promising because they're all built on the logic that they're a field that cares about human decision making, whether it's how you cast a vote, how you buy a product, how you shoot a free throw, how you decide a legal case, how somebody makes a decision out there in the real world. And all of these fields are recognizing, wow, neuroscience is a really important place of information for helping us understand how we make these decisions. The second thing is that they're all really new. And because they're new, each field is still trying to kind of figure out how exactly can neuroscience improve the work that we do? Why do you need to open up the hood of the brain and neuron cells? And they're each dealing with some combination of separating wheat from chaff. And the last thing that I think they all have in common, and this is where the career network really, I think, is relevant, is they're not very diverse. And by that, I mean, understandably, most of this has come from a small group of institutions or a small group of companies. So the institutions involved aren't diverse. The individuals comes from sort of a homogenous set of backgrounds. And we're really trying to shake that up.
When we first looked at the Dana Career Network for Neuroscience and Society website, one of the things that really stood out to us was how many NeuroX careers there are. Did you have an idea of how many careers there were in the cross-section between neuroscience and other fields?
We haven't even finalized how many NeuroX fields there are. Just within the last week with the new RA, we realized we don't have anything on neurosports. And it turns out there's a whole world of neuroscience and athletics, which again, if you think about it, why isn't that starting pitcher able to throw strikes? Why can't, some concentrate when all the pressure's on, but others can? Those are questions of the mind, which means they're questions of the brain. We're trying to find ways to infuse some of these NeuroX careers into more traditionally labeled careers. And I think that when you're doing something pathbreaking, it doesn't necessarily mean you need to do something new. It means that you maybe do something traditional and put a new spin on it as a first cut. And one piece of advice we give to students now is that NeuroX fields won't be labeled NeuroX. So if you Google neurolawyers, you aren't going to find many. But that doesn't mean that neuroscience and law aren't showing up in a lot of places. And an example would be if you're representing a young adult, the job title just says maybe public defender. The job description doesn't mention neuroscience, but increasingly the actual work can benefit from leveraging understanding of neuroscience. And same thing with marketing. It might not say neuromarketer, but if you move into that firm and you've got some better sense of, well, I actually kind of know a little bit about how consumers process this information or how they might respond differently to this ad versus that ad, that can be really advantageous.
I wonder if you could share some anecdotes or stories of some of the students and trainees that you've been working with. And what are you hearing from them? What are they interested in? What do they need as they navigate these careers?
And the best part of working in the career network, the best part of teaching is working with young people and with these students. I'd be remiss if I didn't talk about how fun it's been to work with the students who drive the career network. So we have a website. We don't have a website designer. We have students. We don't have an event planner. We have students. We have now our first ever senior fellow in the career network, postdoc, master's level student. This group of individuals has done everything. Everything you see in the career network comes from this team. And that is just so exciting. I had a student who, as soon as we got a picture, immediately sent it to her mom. Had another picture, a poster. Hey, Francis, can you take a picture? Yeah, sure. I need to send it to my parents. It's just so exciting. I mean, I'm going to get a little emotional talking about it. It's just, that's why it's worth it. And for me, I think after a while, you kind of forget, oh, yeah, we're just doing a poster. But I was in that position too. And to be able to hand it on is really neat. This career network is homegrown and that's really meaningful.
That reminds me of my own career pathway in coming into a role in science philanthropy. I remember I was still a researcher at UCLA in the Semmel Institute for Neuroscience. And at that point, as well as even earlier in my career, I felt that I was being pulled into wanting to explore a career where I could make impact in the world and be able to do that in ways where neuroscience could be leveraged to make that impact. I think my first title after coming out of research was Science Program Associate. And essentially, I was being brought on board to help with event planning. Event planning and event management for science conferences. That was the start. And as I started to explore and grow in a career in science philanthropy that really started at the outset with science event planning, started to exercise more of those muscles of learning how I could infuse that background of neuroscience into a career into philanthropy. And so I think that that openness, and I think also to some extent risk-taking, you know, that jumping into a little bit of an unknown with some of that mentorship that you describe, you know, you want to still have that support system to help prop you up as you're exploring these less defined careers. Those are also critical. I wonder what you could share with us as a sort of message that leaders of science institutions could do to help prepare a next generation of scientists for a career that spans beyond neuroscience.
I think the first and most important thing that both institutions and then the leaders within those institutions, whether it's department chair, or vice provost, or just head of a lab, PI, is be supportive of their students and trainees or their young faculty who voice an interest in doing this interdisciplinary work. This indifference or sometimes outright antagonism towards doing the interdisciplinary work is real. And it's a real hindrance. It shouldn't be something that trainees have to hide, they can do on their nights and weekends. It should be integrated. So that's the first thing. Second thing then is to create incentives to do this. In some spaces, or this is changing and we're in a moment of change, I think some trainees feel that their neuroethics work won't be rewarded or it's not incentivized as much as their more traditional bench lab neuroscience is. And I think that can change, which leads to the third thing. And this is institutionally and kind of broadly across those funding bodies, we need more funding. And I don't even mean in terms of quantity, though, of course, yeah, more money is great. I mean just the types of funding and RFPs and RFAs that are out there integrate some of these societal concerns, even at a very small percentage. It makes a huge difference. And big shout out to NIH Brain Initiative, and of course, Vice President here, Kara Ramos, and many others who have been influential in developing that program. I think they're a real model for how you make neuroethics a part of all of the neuroscience you are doing. When you make it a scored criteria for NIH grant, or when on campus, you create an RFP, even if it's small, just $10,000, and you say, we're going to have, you know, a symposium here, we're going to fund that. That sends a signal, sends real resources. And you combine that with those other things that I mentioned of being supportive and also creating, you know, again, a reward system. Those things aren't common right now, and I hope that they will become more common. This is the mission to train the next generation, and more than just training, to really change policy, institutional policy, to sort of do some of the things that I just, you know, said that I hope would happen. And so we're really, really excited to do it. I think the main thing I'd say is that the reason it's so exciting is the people that we're working with. This is such an uphill battle, but we're so committed to the ideas, the twin ideas that neurotechnology is going to shape society. So it's really important area of growth, but how it shapes society is up to us. So thanks to the Dana Foundation for spurring all that and through the pilot grant, and we hope, you know, future collaboration. NeuroX isn't just about taking neurotechnology or neuroscience insights and applying them in the field. It's also about improving neuroscience research and neurotechnology development. And if you're not getting input from the world that presumably you care about, whether it's patients or it's, you know, societal inputs, then I don't see how you can think that you're optimizing your neuroscience research. You should want those inputs in my mind. So I think better NeuroX is better neuroscience research and better neurotechnology development as well.
Thank you, Francis. Better NeuroX is better neuroscience research.
I think so.
You're making a new motto.
Yes, we got a new motto. Yeah, we got to add that to our website.
Exactly.